first. You'll have 1 minute. House will be followed by Joel Supply and Marguerite Richard.
Hi, my dirty Nazi pig. My name is Alex Zimmerman. I'm president of TDAP America. 60 seconds is very good. Talk against crook like you. You want taxes Amazon, but don't want taxes a bike? Why is privilege have these freaking millionaires? When you spend $100 million for bike, most of them make probably close to 100 grand. So why we don't support homeless with this crook? It's approximately the same 50,000 what is Microsoft have or Amazon. I'm so sorry. So why you Nazi degenerate freaking idiot don't touch him? Is this pay money for homeless? You touch Amazon, but don't touch this crook. You touch Amazon, but don't touch this crook. What is this privilege this millionaire have? $100 million for bike? No penny for homeless? Why? Sieh heil, my Nazi pig! Sieh heil, my Nazi pig! Sieh heil, my Nazi pig, for 1 minute, idiot!
Good afternoon. My name's Joel Sislak. I'm with Capital Hill Housing and a Capital Eco District. And just on a really personal note, in the last 18 months, I was in 2 separate bike accidents on Capitol Hill commuting to work. So I'm very both personally and professionally invested in resolution 31826. As sustainability advocates for Capitol Hill and supporters of Vision Zero, as well as a member of the Community Package Coalition that helps secure community benefits from the Convention Center expansion, we are staunch advocates for the creation of protected bike lanes along Pike and Pine up to Broadway. Bike lanes improve health, reduce carbon emissions, and take pressure off of other transportation systems. Most importantly, protected bike lanes improve safety for riders, which encourages more ridership by a broader and more diverse user base. CHH and the Eco District are committed to working with Seattle Neighborhood Greenways, Central Seattle Greenways, and SDOT to ensure that our business community and all users of the Pike Pine Corridor have a say in how these lanes are designed so that
they're
successful and the lanes are safe, well and safely used. Thank you.
Marguerite, you're going to be followed by Paul Nevsky and then Megan Conway.
Yes, Mr. Sharp here. I think it is a great concern that we have to formulate a network in terms of how people should ride bikes. Specifically, someone was addressing helmets and then others were addressing maybe elderly people where they don't have like a horn, they just like, so you would know that the bicycle is on the side of you or behind you. And I've seen too many people with bicycles and they have no way of telling us that here we come. And I've seen people, well, myself included, walking down the street and all of a sudden I was just missed by a snidget. And if they're all the way down the street 2 blocks and I can't catch them, I can't even stop them and say, why did you just strike me with your bicycle? And I stopped them to pick a little old lady from Pasadena off of the street or the sidewalk. Okay, I had some more.
Paul,
next time.
Hi, my name is Paul Rush. I've been riding for about 14 years. I ride Nottingham, and I see the 50-50 difference. There's a lot of crappy bicycle riders, and there's also good bicycle riders. And I think the hand signals should be more than the helmet, because they don't really stop. And for customers want, I'm going into with the debate. Last day.
Megan's next. Megan, you're going to be followed by Merlin Rainwater and then Margaret Collins. You're going to be joined by Councilman Baker.
Thank you. I'll keep it short. I'm Megan Conway. I've been living in Belltown for 5 years, and only recently have I started biking, mainly because I've seen too many close calls. And what I'm here today is basically just a simple request to build out a basic bike network, because for one reason, it will save lives. And I'm asking you to do this because one in five trips already made on, one in five trips already made on Pike and Pine is already ridden by bicyclists. And if there's more bike lanes in the basic network, people like me can ride, people with children can ride, basically people of all ages and abilities can ride. So I'm asking you to do this today, basically, so keep everyone safe and the safe place. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Melinda Rainwater. I'm 72 years old, and biking is my primary mode of transportation. I hope that it still will be when I'm 82, maybe even when I'm 92. I served on the Bicycle Advisory Board from 2013 to 2017, and during that time we adopted the Bicycle Master Plan with a, my quoting, a central focus of this plan is to design and implement facilities that are safe and appropriate for riders of all ages and abilities. That means separated from car traffic, connected with no dead ends, and connected to meaningful destinations. Intuitive, so that you don't have to be a genius to figure out how to follow this connected route. And finally, I take topography into consideration. I expect that I will always be as vigorous as I am right now, but I hope that I will still be right now. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Margaret. Was
bikes on sidewalks, and I thought this person's sign responded pretty well to that. I mean, we need space where everybody feels safe, and one of the ways to do that is to expand the areas where bikes can be, and that helps people walking, it helps people riding bikes, it also helps people in cars, because when people are riding bikes, like some of our council members, that means they're not driving cars, and so that's more room on the streets for cars. This is a win for everyone, and I hope to do it, so thank you for your time.
Thanks, Bob. Amen. Nate, you're going to be followed by Andrew Kitty, and then that's the last who signed up. We have time for a couple more if people want to line up after him.
Thank you. My name is Ned Wade. I'm with 350 Seattle. I really appreciate this resolution being brought forward. We know that in terms of reducing emissions, bicycle infrastructure is one of the most cost-effective things that we can do. I think the city has reports that it's, you know, requested and learned that that's true. I'm also a little surprised at how calm everyone's been here, given that we've lost another Seattle resident this weekend, because we don't have safe biking infrastructure. I had lived in Seattle for less than a year before I was straight on here and then on this Stockton turn line. This is life and death for most of us, and I really appreciate the professionalism of all the folks in the room, but this is hard stuff for a lot of us, and I think that moving this forward to keep us safe and keep our future safe from climate catastrophe.
You all this is just the most important thing we can do. Hello, my name is Andrew Pitta, and I am a vet from the city. And I come here today with a heavy heart. Another dad in my neighborhood was killed just south of Seattle downfield. He was in the bike lane. He's got two kids and a loving wife, and was just an incredibly sweet human being. He was in the bike lane. We need protected bike lanes.
A resolution relating to the Seattle Tennessee Bike Network establishing an implementation schedule for Seattle Department of Transportation delivery of capital projects that are elements of the Central City Bike Network.
Walk through the substance of the resolution, and then colleagues, after that, we're just here to have a session and ask questions. Thank you for being here, Grossi, representing ESSA, and we also have Matt is here to talk about the process and what happened next.
I'll lead us through just a quick discussion about what is in the resolution, and then we'll have conversation with everyone at the table. So to provide some context for the Center City Bike Network resolution, the city has long been committed to establishing a connected bike network. In 2013, the City of Seattle adopted the Climate Action Plan, which recommends prioritizing transit, walking, and biking over auto travel, with a goal to triple the amount of bicycling from 2007 levels to 2017. In 2014, the city adopted the Bicycle Master Plan and to create a citywide connected network of cycle tracks, protected bike lanes, trail, and greenways with the goal of quadrupling ridership by 2030. The city also adopted a Vision Zero policy and plan with the goal of achieving zero traffic fatalities and serious injuries by 2030. And in 2016, SDOT adopted the Center City Bike Network with the goal of implementing a connected, protected bike lane network in downtown by 2020. In late 2016, implementation of the Center City Bike Network was put on hold while the city partnered with transit agencies and other stakeholders to develop the One Center City near-term recommendations for mobility in downtown. The One Center City recommendations included a two-way protected bike lane on 4th Avenue to be implemented in 2018. As you may know, while we have made significant commitments, there have been significant delays to the implementation of these plans. In April, the city announced the delay of the 4th Avenue two-way protected bike lane until 2021, and an all-ages and abilities bike infrastructure route is still needed to connect from downtown to surrounding neighborhoods in the south, north, and east. We know that from 2019 to 2021, downtown Seattle is expected to experience a period of maximum constraint, in which traffic congestion on downtown streets is anticipated to peak, increasing the need for safe, efficient transportation options to manage individual trips and minimize overall congestion. This resolution outlines a commitment to complete the bike network and move forward with an all-ages and abilities plan. Above and in front of you is a map that's attached to the resolution which has a visual description of the plan. Generally, and we'll walk through the different pieces of it now. Generally, the resolution establishes an implementation schedule for Seattle Department of Transportation delivery of capital projects that are elements of the Center City Bike Network to be completed by December 21st of 2019. So the first section of the resolution, as you can see above in red, commits to establishing an all-ages and abilities bicycle connection from the Westlake Cycle Track through downtown Seattle to the intersections of 2nd Avenue South and South Main Street, and filling in missing connections completed no later than December 31st, 2019, as shown on the map. These additions include protected bike lanes heading in the northbound and southbound direction on 9th Avenue from Harrison Street to Denny, protected bike lanes headed in the northbound and southbound directions on Bell Street from Denny Way to 7th, a one-way protected bike lane on 7th Avenue from Bell to Blanchard, a one-way protected bike lane on 8th Avenue from Bell to Pine, and an improved conceptual design for the segment between Pine Street and Pike Street will be completed by December 31st of 2018 in coordination with King County Metro and the Washington State Convention Center. In addition, a one-way protected bike lane on Pike Street from 6th to 8th, a one-way protected bike lane from Pine Street from 8th to 7th, and signage at Pine Street and 4th Avenue installed by December 31st, 2018 to guide people on bikes safely through the intersection. A one-way bike lane on Pine from 5th to 4th Avenue is expected to be completed in 2021 with the Pike Pine Renaissance, as well as a two-way protected bike lane on the 2nd Avenue extension from South Washington Street to South Main Street. In addition, the next section, section two, as you can see in the presentation, commits to establish an all ages and abilities connection from the intersection of South Main and 2nd Avenue extension to Dearborn Avenue South by no later than December 31st, 2019. In advancing this connection, SDOT is requested to complete outreach and approve conceptual design by no later than May 31st of 2019.
Section 3 commits to establishing an all ages and abilities connection from Second Avenue, from the Second Avenue protected bike lane to the Broadway Avenue protected bike lane by no later than December 31st, 2019. And two-way bike protected lanes on Pike Street, Pine Street, or a combination thereof from Bellevue Avenue to Broadway, and an interim facility on Pike Street and Pine Street from 8th Avenue to Bellevue Avenue during the Convention Center construction. Section 4 acknowledges that where permanent connections described in the resolution may be limited due to construction activities, ESTA is requested to make every good faith effort to establish temporary connections such as working with developers and adjacent property owners in revising traffic control plans to accommodate bicycle travel in addition to pedestrians, or creating bicycle paths using existing adjacent right-of-way with temporary barriers to separate bicycles from vehicle traffic. Section 5 says that the city will commit to completing 100% design for a two-way protected bike lane on 4th Avenue between South Main and Vine by no later than May 31st, 2019. And Section 6, as you can see, the city of Seattle commits to completing 100% design for an all-abilities facility on Bell Street between 2nd and Denny by no later than December 31st, 2019. Section 7 states that the city is commits to establishing a neighborhood greenway from 5th Avenue to 12th Avenue along King Street by no later than December 31st. And the next section acknowledges the city's commitment to establish a connection between Gessler and King along 12th Avenue, again, by no later than December 31st, 2019. Finally, the City Council requests an update on the traffic control manual for in-street work to be implemented by no later than September 1st, 2018. This update will provide guidance for addressing work that encroaches upon a bike lane, bike trail, shared lane, signed bike route, or a road or sidewalk commonly used by bicyclists. An accessible, safe, and clearly defined route should be provided, and maximum effort should be made to provide convenient bicycle way separate from the active work areas. And the council also requests report backs on the progress and commitments made in this resolution to the chair of the Sustainability and Transportation Committee at the start of each calendar quarter from September 2018 through the end of 2019. So now we can
make sure that, well, folks can be divided into some construction. It's not the cost of safety for folks that are walking or biking. I want to ask folks from the Green Air Taxi Bike Club for if you guys be willing to speak a little bit about what your members' experiences have been up to date and what this completion of this network as success and solution you need.
Investments around building connections to the investments.
this really is a personal issue for a lot of people, and this is putting infrastructure into our city streets that will protect people's lives. And you know, the people that are biking on the streets today know that, but the people who are not biking today also know that, and they're making the decision not to bike because they don't feel safe doing so. And if we build out a safe connected network like cities all over the world have done, more and more of those people will make the choice to ride their bikes.
And I know that a number of us or our staff members have experienced incidents, collisions or illnesses, and even injuries in the last few months, and so it's pretty close. Councilor Johnson.
But I'm exactly the person you described, a person who would be much more inclined to be able to move that last mile and a half or 2 miles to downtown where a safer connection that doesn't exist today. So I feel like I'm a living embodiment of that. Somebody who has spent a lot of time as a multi-level advocate, but who feels much safer biking around the neighborhood on the sidewalk with the kids than he does coming downtown. But to a point in the resolution, I think, is great right now, and I might consider a small amendment moving forward, gets to an issue that you touched on briefly, Darby, and that's the idea of if you build it, they will come. We have seen some market improvements on Second Avenue and on Pipeline, and I'll say as an observer of Second Avenue, it doesn't seem like the traffic apocalypse that some of those who oppose the Second Avenue thought would come to fruition has come to fruition. And again, as an observer and transit rider on Fourth Avenue, I actually feel as though the speed and reliability of the 76 that I'm riding that goes on Fourth and makes my right hand turn on to Pine has actually improved once the protective backline has gone in because it went in alongside protection for buses from Pine as well. So I would hope that maybe one of the things you might consider as a friendly amendment, Councilman O'Brien, as this comes to full council, is an amendment that this quarter reports also includes a follow-up about the traffic and mobility impacts that have come to fruition after implementation of protective bike lanes. Because I think that we know from data both in the city but in peer cities that there's a lot of fear about what happens once a bike lane goes in, but the data tends to disprove that fear after the fact. Seattle Times wrote a great article in April earlier this year talking about how Vancouver seen just a dramatic increase not only in cycling cyclists downtown, but also market improvement in the percentages of cyclists who are women, market improvement in the folks who are choosing to be bicyclists commuters for the first time, market positive improvements from their business district because now they were seeing a lot more proactive tenants seeking out locations that were near protected bike lanes because they were seeing so many more of their employees that wanted to bike to work now that there was a protected bike lane. So I think they're there to your point, Clyde, there are a lot of really great societal benefits, be it climate, be it safety, be it public health, frankly, from our budgetary perspective, from the settlements that we have to enter into when a vehicle kills a person who's riding a bike on the street. There's a lot of those benefits, but there's also some really good, hard technical data that I think shows this is better for mobility too. And I think that those reports come to us on a regular basis about the timing of improvements, but also the beneficial some technical data about the data on the streets today.
All right. I appreciate that.
People who are willing to ride their bike despite the substandard conditions, and there's a whole series of people who will ride if there's a completely protected network. And as you said, a network is only as good as its weakest link, so that's absolutely true. And you know, my own staff member was in a bike accident recently, and many of my staff members, and I'm more of a walker than a biker, but my husband rides a bike every. I seem to be the exception to the rule in my family and friends circle who doesn't bike. Most people I know and have connections with in the activist circles also bike. So if there's no question that this is absolutely, if it's a climate change issue, it's a social and economic equity issue, it's a urban sustenance issue, I mean, it's a sustainability issue, there's no question about it. So I have a series of questions, some of which are specific and just also just overall. I have heard that two is the signalization on Second Avenue is such that, I mean, I've heard several people say, is it just anecdotal evidence that I get stopped at every stoplight, or is that actually, I see some
every 2 blocks.
So did I hear somebody say that Fourth Avenue, the plans for it to be two-way, is that the other question I've heard from a lot of constituents and also people I personally know is there any reason why the network is such that at the Broadway and Dessler section, is there any reason why we're not using Word? Because I know a lot of people use the high quality news, so to say.
Yes, because
and then there was one question from a constituent that says, what will be the end result of the construction on eastbound Pike Street as it goes under the convention center? It seems like there are major changes happening to both the traffic and bike lanes. Right now, the sign says bike lane ends right after the bridge. Will that bike lane eventually reconnect to the rest of the network, or are there some other expectations for what bicyclists should do after they cross the bridge from the eastbound?
So we are looking at that entire area, both for the during the construction of the convention center and also kind of the final configuration. And so we kind of have two projects going on right now to look at both of those options to see what we're going to do during the interim and what we're going to put back as a final connection, all the abilities from Second to Broadway.
And that's a really important corridor. We heard about a comment in the videos out there that, about 1 in 5 people using that corridor actually. That's why we really asked the prior time working. It's complicated, there's a lot of construction going on, but there's going to be opportunities, I believe, to both address safety during construction at the convention center and for permanent facilities.
And the one-way public downtown will continue, and right now, looking at a connection using 7th and 8th, that eventually that can